captive for love. My heart will rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord who has been bountiful with me. Oh Lord, I trust in your merciful love. My heart will rejoice in your salvation.
Welcome to our celebration of the seventh Sunday in Ordinary Time. If you are with us on Zoom, please remain muted during the service, except when we pray the Lord's Prayer and exchange peace with one another. Stop judging, and you will not be judged. Stop condemning, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. This is what Jesus is telling us to do. There's no asterisk or extra context. This is it. Love your enemies. Pray for those who mistreat you. Lend expecting nothing back. Stop judging. Stop condemning. Forgive. That's it. That's the point. That's the path to heaven. Please stand and join in the gathering song.
All are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome. All are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. Welcome all the brokenhearted, all with sorrow and despair. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim. All are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome. All are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome. All belong. Welcome all who suffer violence. All who long for safety and for peace. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim. All are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome. All are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome. All belong. Welcome all who are forgotten, excluded and ignorant. dignity denied. You are not alone, for you are God's own. Together we sing and we proclaim, all are welcome in this place. Behold love's amazing grace. All are welcome, all are welcome. Bring your hopes, bring your dreams. Mercy flows and love redeems. All are welcome, all belong. All are welcome, all belong, all are welcome, all belong.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also.
As a community of faith dedicated not to judge others and to offer forgiveness, we ask help to remain worthy of God's grace. Lord Jesus, you call us to see all life as precious. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you show us how to live as citizens of heaven. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you challenge us to love our enemies. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. Praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer.
You are seated right hand of the Father,
have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that always pondering spiritual things, we may carry out in both word and deed that which is pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. In those days, Saul went down to the desert of Ziph with 3,000 picked men of Israel and searched for David in the desert of Ziph. So David and Abishai went among Saul's soldiers by night and found Saul lying asleep within the barricade, with his spear thrust into the ground at his head, and Abner and his men sleeping around him. Abishai whispered to David, "God has delivered your enemy into your grasp this day. Let me nail him to the ground with one thrust of the spear. I will not need a second thrust." But David said to Abishai, "Do not harm him, for who can lay hands on the Lord's anointed and remain unpunished?" So David took the spear and the water jug from their place at Saul's head, and they got away without anyone's seeing or knowing or awakening. All remained asleep because the Lord had put them into a deep slumber. Going across to an opposite slope, David stood on a remote hilltop as a great distance from Abner, son of Ner, and the troops. He said, "Here is the king's spear. Let an attendant come over to get it." The Lord will reward each man for his justice and faithfulness. Today, that the Lord delivered you into my grasp, I will not harm the Lord's anointed." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Loving and forgiving are you, O Lord, slow to anger, rich in kindness. Loving and forgiving are you. Loving and forgiving are you, to anger, rich in kindness, loving and forgiving are you. All my being, bless the Lord, bless the holy name of God. All my being, bless the Lord, remembering the goodness of God. Loving and forgiving are you, O Lord, slow to anger, rich in kindness, loving and forgiving are you. God forgives us all our sins, healing those who live in pain,
saving us from final death, God fills us with goodness and love. Loving and forgiving are you, O Lord, slow to anger, rich in kindness. Loving and forgiving are you. Good and gracious is the Lord, slow to anger, rich in love. God remembers not our sins, forgiving and loving is God. Loving and forgiving are you, O Lord, slow to anger, rich in kindness. Loving and forgiving are you.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, the last Adam, a life-giving spirit. But the spiritual was not first, rather the natural and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, earthly, the second man from heaven. As was the earthly one, so also are the earthly. And as is the heavenly one, so also are the heavenly. Just as we have borne the image of the earthly one, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly one. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Let your heart rejoice in the Lord, let your word proclaim his deeds, let your heart sing out to the world that our God has come to save. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, to you who hear, I say, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. To the person who strikes you on one cheek, offer the other as well. From the person who takes your cloak, do not withhold even your tunic. Give to everyone who asks of you, and from the one who takes what is yours, do not demand it back. Do to others as you would have them do to you. For if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, then what credit is that to you? Even sinners do the same. If you lend money to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners and get back the same amount. But rather, love your enemies and do good to them and lend expecting nothing back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High. For God himself is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Stop judging, and you will not be judged. Stop condemning, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and gifts will be given to you. A good measure, packed together, shaken down, and overflowing, will be poured into your lap. For the measure with which you measure will in return be measured out to you. The Gospel of the Lord. In the autumn of 1883, a slave ship was docked in Maryland, and 272 slaves, men, women, and children, were forced onto that boat, having been sold to plantations in the South, in the Deep South, New Orleans. And it wouldn't have been in those days, in the midst of that horrendous, unbelievably horrendous thing called slavery, that wouldn't have been an unusual sight, necessarily, but there was something different about these 272 men, women, and children who were being sold to plantations in the South. They were all owned by Jesuit priests. They were all owned by the Jesuits who run Georgetown University of Maryland province. They had slaves, and the university, which is now the premier Catholic university in the United States, Georgetown University, probably costs $60,000 plus to go there per year. It is now the premier Catholic university in the United States, but it was going broke. And it was ordered by the Jesuit general in Rome not to sell those slaves to cover the price of it. Why they had slaves in the first place is another reason. And they did it anyway. They did it to save the university. They sold 272 men, women, and children into more greater misery in order to save their university. Now, how does, and there's a black woman at that university, she has a position at that university, and she's found this out, of course, because all this has come to light, and there's been a great deal of research to find who are the descendants of those slaves who were sold. And now, how is that woman, whose descendants were one of those men, women, and children, actually a 14-year-old boy, how is she going to work in that university and forgive that university for what it's done? And how is she going to work with Jesuits every day and forgive those Jesuits for what they did? Now, those Jesuits that she works with every day, they didn't sell her ancestors. But how in the world are they not going to have the kind of situation that where there's uneasiness in the presence of one another because we know the history? And so the Jesuits of Georgetown University, in conversation with many of the descendants who have been identified, they've agreed, they came to an agreement to set up a foundation and for the Jesuits to raise $100 million and put in that foundation to go to especially scholarships for Black Americans who want to go to, or Black, they don't have to be Americans, Black people in general who want to go to Georgetown University and other things. And so the Jesuit order makes reparations. The truth is brought out and they make reparations. But how is it that white people are going to be in the presence of Black people anywhere and not feel a little bit unease because we know what we did? We know what the past is like. And it hasn't all been admitted, and it hasn't all been healed, and it hasn't all been made reparation for. And how are we not going to feel a little bit unease? Because we know the past hasn't been healed. So in our gospel, Jesus talks about the centrality of forgiveness for our Christian faith. And we have to believe that that's true. The only thing is, in our time, we've discovered dimensions to that forgiveness that we probably didn't think of not too long ago. And one of those dimensions is, how do you forgive history? Because we've been focused on, we've been champions of how to forgive another person for snoring too loud at night, or our spouse, or cutting us off. We've been experts at that. But how are we going to forgive history? How are we going to forgive systematic racism and systematic bias and policies that are meant to punish people of color, immigrants, refugees? How do we forgive history? How do we forgive society and the social sins that are still in the society, in the setup, in the very setup of society? That's not something that our Catholic ancestors necessarily faced the way we do. And we have to find new ways to do this. And we're not very good at it yet. I mean, I think that's, we can just absolutely say, we believe Jesus is absolutely right. Forgiveness is at the heart of who we are. But this is a new area that we haven't become aware of before, where forgiveness is needed, and we're not very good at it yet. The Jesuits at Georgetown were not so good at it. They're trying to do better. And so we have to believe, Jesus, that forgiveness is at the heart of all of this. But there are new areas where we need to learn how to forgive, and we're not very good at it yet. And one of them, one of those areas, is the sins of the past. How do we forgive somebody who's dead? How do we forgive the systematic exploitation and evil that's been done to minority people? That's a challenge. We're not very good at it yet, and we have to try to get better. We've been better at one-on-one, and yet there's a new area that has opened up for forgiveness about one-on-one people too, and that's people who were abused by a priest, by a teacher, by a trusted scout leader, by a trusted family member. And those people's whole lives have been colored and shaped by abuse that happened in the past. And how does that person forgive their abusers? How do women who have been sexually assaulted, how do they forgive their abusers? We haven't faced those questions with the reality of those questions in the past and the way that we have to now. And we're learning a little bit, and we're just at the beginning of learning. Because one of the things that we've learned about victims of abuse as a child is that quick forgiveness is not going to work. Because in the past, we've been about quick forgiveness. Come on, you got to forgive. Come on, you got to forgive them. Get on with it. Well, that's not going to work. not to people who've been deeply scarred, the people who are victims, who have been, that is, quick forgiveness is not going to do it. Lots of reasons. It doesn't give the person who, the perpetrator, time to truly repent. Our Christian community was really aware that people would sin and that they would need to be brought back, but they always required repentance first. And quick forgiveness doesn't give the perpetrator time to truly repent. And we know that perpetrators of violence and abuse to others, they will cry at the drop of a hat because they feel bad about what they've done. But that's a million miles away from repentance and going in the other direction. Just feeling bad is not repentance. And so forgiving, how many women have been told, have been sitting in front of a priest with black eyes and a shoulder out of joint and told to forgive her abusive husband and to go back into that home? That's not the way. We have to ask, if Jesus is saying that forgiveness is at the heart of things, we have to ask, what is he asking for from that kind of forgiveness? Is that it? To go back into it, to a cycle of violence? And we have to say, no, that is not what Jesus is talking about. So one of the things that we have found about people who've been traumatized by some kind of sin or abuse is that they spend their whole lives trying to feel forgiven. They go to forgiveness again. They go to confession. They again and again and again and again, and they keep asking for forgiveness for the same thing, and they never feel forgiven. And you know why? Because you can't feel forgiven for what you didn't do. And when somebody's been abused, the abuser has made them feel like it's their fault, that it's the victim's fault. And so they ask for forgiveness their whole lives, trying to feel forgiven for something they're not responsible for, so they never feel forgiven. And so we don't treat people who have, in that awful situation, we don't do quick forgiveness. We say, get safe. First of all, get safe. 3 years, 5 years. We'll talk about what forgiveness might mean, but that's not going to help now. It's not going to help anybody right now. And so we're trying to learn this new area of forgiveness in our time, when the challenges are incredible in our society. There's so little reconciliation, truth and reconciliation type commissions, repentance, healing and forgiveness. It's a huge job that we have ahead of us. And yet, Jesus is absolutely right. We have to believe he's absolutely right. It's where we have to get to. But we have some new challenges, and we don't know how, we're not very good at meeting them yet. And we have to become people of healing and get better and better at it. We have specialized in one-on-one forgiveness, and psychology will tell us that that is absolutely essential. That Jesus is absolutely right. Forgiveness is at the heart of life. And if we're not people who can forgive, the people we're hurting are mostly us. We're destroying our health, and we're destroying our psychological health. We're killing our souls. A moment of humor. Some of you, veterans of life, may remember a comedian named Buddy Hackett. And anybody who shakes their head is giving their age away, seriously. But Buddy Hackett was a comedian. And he said, you know, when you're mad at that guy who cut you off and you are trying and you're thinking all these bad things about him and you know what he's doing while you're doing that? He's doubt dancing. So who's getting punished? You're punishing yourself. And psychologists have told us this is so unhealthy. This is incredibly unhealthy. When we want to poison that person for what they've done to us, We are releasing poison into our systems and we're poisoning ourselves. Psychology talks about wound collectors, people who collect their wounds. And they look for the wounds that have been done to them. And they gather their wounds together and they set them out there and they relive their feelings of anger and outrage and they're poisoning themselves. Because they can't let the past, they can't get the forgiveness. Forgiveness is a way of saying the past will not get better. It's giving up on the hope that the past will get somehow better. It won't. So then now, what are we going to do? There was a priest who was raised thinking that in order to be a good priest, he had to be nice to everybody, and so he would never have any enemies because everybody would be his friend. Well, he was a young priest, and so that didn't last all that long because, of course, he had experiences in life where he was betrayed, and betrayal is one of the most painful things that can happen to us. And he was a pastor of a church, and there's no way you can be pastor of a church without having enemies because you'll change something. And as someone has said, if you'd like to get an enemy, change something. And so he gets to the end of his later in life and he realizes he has a whole list of enemies. He was trying not to have any enemies. He got a whole list. But then he had an insight. Jesus said to pray for your enemies. He didn't say not to have any, because Jesus had a ton of enemies. They eventually killed him. He didn't say don't have enemies. He said pray for your enemies. Love your enemies. And this priest all of a sudden had an insight that he didn't feel so bad about the enemies list because he realized I couldn't do what Jesus said because I didn't have enemies. You can't pray for them unless you got them. You can't forgive them unless you got them. And now he was very happy because he had a whole list of people that when he couldn't sleep at night, he would get out his enemies list and he would pray for God to bless those people, to bless them with the very best that they could. And his heart began over time to melt and to soften, and the forgiveness became more and more real to him. So we have to believe that Jesus is right when he says that the forgiveness is at the very heart of everything. But maybe it's time for us Catholics to maybe also admit we have new challenges and we're not very good at it yet. And so that is going to have to be our work. Is learning how to help people in all of these situations, how healing can take place, how the past can be washed clean and healed. So let's come to this table. And eventually what we have to say, even to people who have been traumatized and abused, eventually, what we have to say is this. Eventually, if we're going to believe Jesus, eventually we have to let go of the past. And we have to find a way to forgive. Because if we don't, this is what will happen. And we know, we've seen it 1,000 times. Psychology will tell you this in any textbook. If you hang on to being a victim and make your whole identity the victim, and they require everybody to give you special treatment because you are a victim, worse than anybody else. What will happen is, pretty soon, when people don't treat you like you think you should be, you'll think it's okay to victimize them. You'll think you'll become the perpetrator. You'll become a person who hurts other people because it's okay because I'm a victim, so I can hurt other people. And then you become the person that you hate. You become the victimizer that you hate. So it doesn't work. At some point, we have to say to people who have been deeply, deeply scarred and hurt, still, at some point, you may not be able to forgive now. And nobody gets to tell you you have to be It has to be quick forgiveness. It takes the time it takes you. It is a process that may take years, and that's fine. Nobody gets to tell you you have to forgive right now. But what we can say is, if you can't forgive right now, can you open your hands and give it to God? And say, God, can you give me the grace of forgiveness? Can you soften my heart? Can you give me something I don't have, which is the ability to be healed and forgiven? Because we have to remember about forgiveness and reconciliation. Who's more interested in forgiveness and reconciliation than anybody else? Well, it's not you and me, it's God. God is the author of reconciliation and forgiveness. And so this Sermon on the Plain here is not something that we turn into some kind of law, all these things Jesus said, into little laws. It's to get the point of where Jesus is at. And I think that point is this, is that Jesus lived and taught in a way that adds up to this teaching about life. It is better to suffer evil than it is to do evil. Jesus wasn't a punching bag that just said, when they wanted to throw him off a cliff, he walked out and got away. He got away from the evil. But there were times in Jesus' life when he was backed into the corner and he had one choice, do evil or suffer evil. And what Jesus said is, then it is better to suffer evil. That's the teaching of Jesus, as far as I can see it. It is better to suffer it then. And the reason seems to be, is that when we do something, when we make a decision and have an action, we think of that, okay, I'm just doing that. We think of one effect, I'm doing that. But every action that we have has a double effect. We're doing that, but it's also making us the kind of person who's doing that. And so if I steal all the time, it's not just that I steal, I've made myself to be a thief. I've created a person who is a thief. If I lie all the time, it's not just that I lie. I have made myself to be a liar. And what seems clear about Jesus is that he would not make himself to be an evil person by doing evil. He would rather suffer it than do it. So I guess what I want to say, and I'm sorry for the length of this homily. This has gone a bit long. You're lucky because it went longer last night. Is that we are in the heart of Jesus' teaching about the kingdom of God, and it is mystery. Part of that mystery is the mystery of forgiveness, and it is incredibly needed in our world. And yet, there are new areas that have opened up that need our forgiveness, or that we need to learn how to forgive, how to wash clean, and how to find healing. And we don't know that. We haven't got it all down yet. And so we're going to have to continue to ask God to give us the grace to know how to heal, to become healers. We all have to be healers. And to learn how to forgive in a way that is true and healing. So let's come to this altar tonight. And if we have things from the past that we can't forgive, let's come with open hands and say, God, I can't forgive yet, but I can open my hands and say, you take it and help me forgive. Let us stand now and declare our faith in the Lord. It is our Lord God, who is the author of reconciliation and forgiveness. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and of earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life that is everlasting. Amen. As a people of faith, we pray for our enemies and want only the best for all people. Faced with this great challenge, we present these prayers to God.
Our response is, hear our prayer.
Hear our prayer.
For all the faithful and for the ongoing challenge to pray for those who do not walk with us. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer.
For local and world leaders, may they make decisions based on the good of others rather than self-interest. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer.
That all who are hurting in body, mind, or spirit may know the compassion of God. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer.
For our enemies, for a conversion of heart among those who ridicule or seek the demise of those who support a differing point of view. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer.
For this community, for a renewed spirit of forgiveness, peace, and harmony. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer.
For those who suffer addictions of any kind, for healing, not judgment. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer.
For the prayers we hold in silence, and for those listed in the book of prayer and in the bulletin, that God's love and peace flood their hearts with comfort. God of forgiveness.
Hear our prayer. O God, you are the example of perfect love and mercy. May we live and act in your image so that we may continue to make your kingdom present in this world. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
There is a place for the sadness. Hold on to love. There is a season of gladness. Hold on to love. Pain and confusion seem endless. Hold on to love. We cultivate healing through kindness. Hold on to love. Hold on to love where hope is found. Hold on to love where joy abounds. Hold on to love where grace and mercy overflowing. Hold on to love. And faith will sustain us. Hold on to love. When violence seeks to destroy us, hold on to love. of compassion restore us. Hold on to love. Hold on to love where hope is found. Hold on to love where joy abounds. Hold on to love where grace and mercy overflowing. Hold on to love. Hatred is used to divide us. Hold on to love. Wisdom and truth will unite us. Hold on to love. When prejudice poses as freedom, hold on to love. Dignity means all are welcome. Hold on to love. Hold on to love where hope is found. Hold on to love where joy abounds. Hold on to love where grace and mercy overflowing. Hold on to love where hope is found. Hold on to love where joy abounds. Hold on to love where grace and mercy overflowing. Hold on to love. Hold on to love.
Hold on to love. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. As we celebrate the mysteries, O Lord, with the observance that is your due, we humbly ask you that we offer, that what we offer to the honor of your majesty may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just that we should give you thanks and praise, O God, for all that you do in this world through our Lord Jesus Christ. For though the human race is divided by dissension and discord, yet we know that by testing us, you change our hearts and prepare them or reconciliation. Even more, by your Spirit, you move human hearts that enemies may speak to each other again, that adversaries may join hands, and people seek to meet together. By the working of your power, it comes about, O Lord, that hatred is overcome by love, that revenge gives way to forgiveness, and discord is changed to mutual respect. And therefore, as we give you ceaseless thanks with the choirs of heaven, we cry out to your majesty on earth, and without end we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
You therefore, Almighty God, we bless through Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation to us, the hand that you reach out to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves had turned far away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled and forgiven, O Lord, so that converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation that Christ has brought us, sanctify these gifts by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and the blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. For when about to give his life to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." And in a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing your mercy, and he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and the resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed upon us already, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. And Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also, together with your Son, and in this saving banquet, graciously to endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us to one another. And may he make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. And may he keep us in communion with Francis, our Pope, and Alexander, our Bishop, with all of the bishops and your entire people everywhere that your Son has gained for you. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together again with the glorious Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with your blessed apostles, with St. Charles, with St. Ignatius of Loyola, and with all of the saints, but also with all of our brothers and our sisters, and those of every race and every tongue and language who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. 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 Amen.
We invite those at home on Zoom to unmute at this time. And at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, You said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not upon our sins, look instead upon the faith of your church, and graciously grant to her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer one another a sign of the peace of Christ.
Peace be with everybody.
Peace be with you.
Peace.
Christ should be.
Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Russell. Peace be with you.
Thanks.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be.
Just a reminder, you're welcome to come forward for communion. Our practice is to use the near side aisles to come forward and exit to the far side aisles. And Thomas on this side and Dotto on this side will help direct traffic.
I am the bread of life, I am the hope in life, I am the door wide open, I am the shepherd's might, I am the truth and light, I am the way and life, I am who am and I am for you, come and follow me. Sorrow. I come to those who are in need. today and for tomorrow. Light for all who want to see. I am the bread of life. I am the hope in night. I am the door wide open. I am the shepherd's mind. I am the truth and light. I am the way and life. I am who am and I am for you. Come and follow me. I give my heart to those in sorrow. I come to those who are in need. Hope for today and for tomorrow. Life for all who want to see. I am the bread of life. I am the hope in night. I am the door wide open. I am the shepherd's mind. I am the truth and life. I am the way and life. I am who am and I am for you. Come and follow me. I am who am and I am for you. Come and follow me.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that we may experience the effects of the salvation which is pledged to us by these mysteries, through Christ our Lord. Please be seated for our announcements.
Be sure to pick up a bulletin on your way out. If you have a donation, please put in a box in the back. We appreciate your financial support. Also, there is a new issue of the Catholic Sentinel in English and Spanish. If you have palm branches from last year's Palm Sunday, please bring them in and place it in the basket in the entryway. We will burn them to make ashes for Ash Wednesday. Thank you. Lent begins with Ash Wednesday on March 2nd. We will have two masses on that day, 11:20 a.m., the LaSalle School Mass. You are welcome to attend. And 7 p.m., Paris Mass. Blessed Ashes will be available for self-application in the church throughout the afternoon. See details for all our Lent activities in the bulletin. Next weekend is a commitment weekend for the Archbishop's Catholic Appeal. If you received a personalized commitment card in the mail, please bring it with you to Mass next weekend to drop in the collection. Commitment cards will be available for anyone who needs one. The Multicultural Committee will meet after Mass today in the Commons. It is an important meeting to discuss the Pope's Synod listening process. Please plan to attend. Hospitality after Mass will resume after Mass in the Commons. Join us for coffee, a donut, some juice, and nice conversation. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Judy Ludwigson, and we're so happy to be starting hospitality today, get to get back to visiting together and coffee and donuts. What we've done is ask the ministries and committees to host throughout the year about three times each. And we're also, so that we have enough people to host, we're asking you as our parishioners to also host. So it's just about two or three people right after Mass. You'd serve the donuts and they're all laid out and clean up afterwards. So it's quite easy. We have a sign up sheet out in the hallway. And so please give your name and phone number and email so we can contact you. We'll send you an email during the week before that you are scheduled to host. So we appreciate that. And we can show you how to go about doing it too. Thank you for being a part of our parish and for adding to our community for hospitality.
Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Cora. Good morning. My name is Leif Kerwald, pastoral coordinator here. Welcome to all of those of you who might be new or visiting or back. Great to have you here. Just a couple of additional things. First Communion class is today in the physics lab, which is right through those two doors back there. Please be sure to pick up a bulletin. You'll find them near all of the exits because today's bulletin has been lovingly stuffed with some really good resources. The blue insert in your bulletin describes our program, Reading the Bible Rebelliously. Session number two occurs this Tuesday night in the Commons at 7 p.m. with Dave Gregory, theology teacher of De La Salle. The readings for this class have been posted on the webpage. So you'll find information about that in the bulletin and in this flyer. The yellow insert in your bulletin describes the synod listening process that we are engaged in. And I want you to read through the material carefully and reflect closely on, particularly on the three questions that we are inviting you to respond to. We invite you to respond however you wish and say whatever you think you need to say, but with the hope that these questions will help you. And I'd like to just read them to you now so that you can cook on them. How is God present in your life? And in what ways does the church support or fail to support that presence? Second, what experiences of the Catholic Church have brought you joy? What experiences have wounded you? Third, what is the single most important step the church should take in the next 5 years? These three questions are at the core of the listening that we wish to do, at the listening that Pope Francis wishes to do. And there's a host of ways for you to respond. We have scheduled conversations coming up soon, both in person and on Zoom, but there's also the opportunity to respond individually on your own through our web portal or email or send us a letter. The handout describes that in some detail. It also provides a worksheet for you with the three questions. And page 2 of the handout is a beautiful, beautiful homily that Pope Francis gave last fall to open the synod listening process. So please take a look at those things. The last little announcement that I have is next week, next Sunday, we will have a Voice of the Community reflection on the Word by Tom Ficker right after Sunday Mass, probably right up here in the chapel, but we'll figure out a way for you to get your coffee and either come back or do it over there. We'll figure it all out, but please plan on a Voice of the Community reflection on the Word. Lastly, we want to say a prayer for Sister Phyllis because she will be having a cataract surgery on Tuesday. And we need you, Sister Phyllis. So we're gonna prop you up with our prayers and trust that that all will be well. So please come forward and I'm gonna turn it over to Father Jerry for the prayer.
Sister, can we get you to come up here in front of everybody so we can embarrass you properly? Just look out there at everybody. Please extend your hands in blessing. Almighty God, we come to you. We ask for the presence of Christ the healer for our sister. We ask that you would be with her as she goes on this into this medical procedure. We ask you to give her good people who will be at their best. We ask you to bring healing to her eyes, and we ask you to return her to us with a clearer physical vision, but also clearer spiritual vision. And so we ask you to meet her as Christ the healer and heal her in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go forth in peace and forgiveness. The Mass is ended.
With one voice the angels sing, songs that make creation ring. Prophets hear and call us to live in spirit and in truth. Word of God enthroned, dwell in us forevermore. Love has come to show the way. Alleluia, peace be with us. Love has come to show the way.
breathe on me your very life. Grace will make the darkness bright. Word of God and throne, dwell in us forevermore. Love has come to show the way.
She's gonna wait. She's thinking of the attitude about the guy with the mask here.
Peace be.